forgotten. It took all the footage off my TV. Said it's too disturbing for you and me. It'll just breed a...
Welcome to The American Spirit. I'm your host, Stuart Thomas, and today we're going to look at an aspect of the American spirit we haven't looked at much, if at all, during the series that we've been having on this topic. It's called competition. And we have with us the general manager of a radio station that is in competition with a lot of radio stations here in Tucson. I looked in the This Week in TV in the Arizona Daily Star on Sunday, and I counted 36 radio stations in Tucson. And I also looked in the Inside Tucson Business Book of Lists, and they are in the top 20. They're number 16 in terms of listenership. However, they're the number one independent station in terms of listenership. There are a lot of conglomerates in Tucson. There are places like, Clear Channel owns, besides the ones in Tucson, altogether, they own, they're the largest owner, 1,182 domestic radio stations, plus they're involved in outside the U.S. radio stations too. Citadel Broadcasting owns 203 radio stations. Lotus Communication owns 24 radio stations west of the Mississippi River. Journal Communications owns 38 radio stations. And the University of Arizona owns four. If you're curious what they are, it's KUAZ AM and FM and KUAT FM 90.5 and 89.7. Well, number 16 on the list, and there, as I say, 36 of them, is KJLL. The owner owns one station, and it's called KJLL 1330 AM. It's hot news and talk. Hudson Communication is the owner. That's the name of the
ownership, yeah.
Right?
We call it the Jolt.
But it's right. The station itself is called the Jolt. Hot news, hot talk all the time, right?
All the time, hot news, hot talk.
Well, welcome to the show, Pat.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you having me here. I'm afraid of all this competition. I lost count. 36 stations.
36 stations
in
Tucson.
That's a lot to go over, isn't it?
It really is. It really is. I had no idea we had so many, but anyone can check that out by looking in the Arizona Daily Star on Sunday in the TV section.
Well, when you're in radio, you kind of pay attention to that sort of thing.
Well, certainly. Well, certainly. Now, you're not the only news talk in town, but you're the highest rated independent news talk in town, which is pretty amazing. I mean, the number one radio station for news talk is part of a conglomerate of 1,182 domestic radio stations.
Not counting TV and billboards, if you
want
to just throw those in. So they're big.
That is true. So how do you do it? How do you stay competitive?
Well, the first thing, we can turn on a dime. You know, when you're in a smaller operation, you can do things quicker and faster. When you're up against larger corporations, they have to have meetings, involve people from all over the country. So what I do is I go to all the conventions and I find out what talent is out there and try to grab that talent quicker than they can. And that's how we started over the last 4 years, you know, to build our, you know, herd of cattle that we have there, so to speak.
And you have quite a lineup. I'm very impressed. You have Imus in the morning to start off with. You also have Doc Phillips. He does the local part of it.
Yes.
We're showing you actually on the monitor right now. That's from 6 to 10 a.m. Then from 10 a.m. to noon, you've got the Radio Factor with Bill O'Reilly. He's one of my favorite people to listen to.
He was interesting to meet. I had a fight against him to get him about 2.5 years ago. This is an example of trying to get ahead of the competition because Talk was the other, the Clear Channel station was looking to take him on too because he was going to roll out this big show. So I went to a convention in Las Vegas and actually had a conversation with them in Westford One, you know, to convince them that, you know, we're a hard-working little radio station and we need some help, and Bill decided to do that for us.
That's pretty amazing, considering they're so large and you're not. I guess he really believed in what you're doing.
Well, some of them do. When you get to meet some of these, they come from small roots in the beginning. They all started at small radio stations. So my plea with them is, hey, give me a chance. I'm up against all these big guys, but I can still produce numbers for you, and you can help us grow together.
Yeah.
You know, that's the concept of it.
Seems to have worked.
So far, so good.
I don't always agree with him, but he's very, very interesting to listen to.
Well, the idea of radio is not whether you agree with it or not.
Yeah.
I mean, the concept of the station just in itself is to have a balance, not just all conservative. I have Alan Combs on. I have Tom Likas. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, actually, we're gonna go right down the line here. After Bill O'Reilly, you got Laura Schlesinger. That must have been a huge coup.
Well, that was almost a year in the workings.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of my proudest, actually, moments is when I was able to actually take her from the other radio station.
Yeah, that was the Clear Channel radio station, too, with 1,082 domestic radio stations.
I think they were lost for about 2 weeks after she started with the Jolt.
Wow.
Yeah, because they didn't have anything to replace her right away.
Incidentally, these numbers that I got through InfoLine, which is the free line of the public library system here, the Tucson Pima Library.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone can call them, 791-4010. I have their number by heart, because anything I don't know, I feel that it's researchable, I go to them.
Excellent.
So anyway, so Dr. Laura Schlesinger's on from 12 to 3.
Mm-hmm.
Then you got Glenn Beck from 3 to 6. What is this Talkers number 6 USA?
Well,
what does that mean?
He's another example. I met him in Philadelphia a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And when we lost the other big show that I had for a while, mm-hmm. you know, Sean Hannity, I'll just tell it like it is.
Right. Yeah, but you've recovered with a whole lot of other people.
Yes, I did. But at the time, it was a hard hit when he did what he did. So they convinced me that Glenn Beck was an up-and-coming show. Mm-hmm. And I talked with him. I kind of liked what I heard. And we threw him on the Jolt. He's been there for about a year and a half now.
Mm-hmm. Then you got somebody that, I don't know, it probably appeals to a younger crowd called the Tom Likas Show.
Well,
he's pretty controversial, I think. But,
well, he's very controversial, actually. Well, you know, I mean, if guys want to, he teaches men how to go out and not spend any money and have a pleasurable night with women. That's his deal. You know, so
I've heard it a number of times, and even some of the women either love him or hate him.
Well, yeah, there's no in between. The time, trust me.
The ones that love him think they're doing him the favor by telling them about what men want.
Well, that's the thing. He can convince them that you need to know exactly how they do things so that you'll know how to move forward one way or the other. That's the idea of it.
Then you have the Alan Combs Show, and this says liberal political. He's probably one of the very few liberal people on radio.
It's hard to find generally very liberal shows just in talk radio.
Uh-huh.
I mean, the nature of the beast is to be conservative. Probably 90% of everything out there is conservative talk. So he's another person that I went and met in Philadelphia. And said he was just coming on Fox Radio Network, and I still wasn't a Fox affiliate, so I met with them, and I thought that'd be a great, you know, little marriage for us to pick up another affiliate. And Fox is pretty big with, you know, the TV stuff, but now the radio stuff's getting pretty big.
Well, you're not a Fox affiliate, are you?
I am now with Alan Combs.
Fox Radio Network. Oh, okay. All right. Well, congratulations.
A little bit here, a little bit there. That's how it works.
So you lose Sean Hannity, but you get Alan Combs.
Yeah, well,
very good.
Hopefully Alan can beat Sean up someday. That would be nice.
Then you got America at Night with Ernie Brown.
Yeah.
That's on very late, from 2 to 5 a.m. I've listened to it a bit. It is interesting. Talk a little bit about that, though, because most viewers have not seen it.
Yeah, the thing about it is night shifters, there's a whole new world of those individuals, and they're in factories, and they're working all-night jobs, and they like radio. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to find something live where they can call in. Now, what Ernie Brown does is he deals with any general subject matter, and then he also brings the news in from Europe across the continent. So at 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, they're talking about stuff that's going on in maybe, you know, Afghanistan, Iraq, England, Europe, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah, that's really good. There's even more of a need for that than there used to be, because KTKT used to be at all news all the time, and it isn't.
Well, that was pretty brief.
Exist
that was
short. Context.
That was very short and sweet. Wasn't
it? Well, yeah, but before they went to the talk shows, it was all news all the time too for a while. I've been here since '86, and so they for a while they were that, and I would tune in and different times whenever I wanted to hear the up and coming news. Now it's a Spanish, Hispanic music.
I think
station.
We could go Monday. It turned Spanish.
Yeah.
They're still going to honor their commitment to NFL football. I think they're still broadcasting the Cardinal games.
I see.
But everything else is Spanish.
Yeah.
You know. So, and it's a shame because one of the things that radio's gotten big, just in general, in terms of local talent, it doesn't exist putting local talent on anymore.
But I've seen you pick up some people, and when we get to the Saturday and Sunday, where we'll talk a little bit about that. So then you've got First Light with Dirk Van. I don't think I've ever heard that.
That's another show that there's a lot of people on the west part of the country that want to know what's happening with just the United States news and the stock market. opening. Mm-hmm. You see, when it's 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, it's 7, 8 o'clock in the morning in New York, mm-hmm. where they start the action starts to happen on the East Coast. Mm-hmm. So he's dealing with that, and people are listening to that, live on this side of the country.
So you've got a dynamite lineup here. I've heard that Imus is probably the best listened to of all the shows.
Imus is the flagship. We had him. We'll be actually 6 years old in February, mm-hmm. and he's the flagship. Mm-hmm. And Imus brings a very upscale listenership in terms of, mm-hmm. We're looking for, we started with that 35 to 64 as far as the mm-hmm. demo. Imus brings a lot more male, 60-40% male than mm-hmm. Some of the other shows do. But he's still the flagship of the radio station.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I imagine Dr. Laura Schlesinger brings a lot of, actually, as I think of it, you've got a lot of people bringing people. Bill O'Reilly, Dr. Laura, I would think Alan Colmes. And Glenn Beck is new, but I think he's a winner.
Well, that's the reason why the radio station's gone up in ratings.
Well, yeah.
It's the whole package put together.
Good for you.
Yeah, so.
Now, you also have special programming. What is that? Talk a little bit about that.
Well, I started with different things. Chit Chat was one of those, an example of finding some niche. Going to the conventions, you get to meet some of these people that are trying to get their product out in smaller markets. So Chick Chat was one of those shows.
So what is that about?
Two ladies that are on at night, late at night, okay. Heidi and Laura, and they talk about all the things that women want to talk about. It's kind of the opposite of the Tom Likas thing.
Oh, okay.
For ladies.
Okay.
We'll leave it at that.
And
they tell you how to dress and what instruments to use and things like that.
Oh, okay. Are they pretty graphic at times?
They can be, yeah.
Well, they are.
They even
give
you model numbers and what batteries
to use. Oh, my goodness. Okay. And then Twilight Zone on the radio. Well, that's pretty obvious. I actually have heard
Stacey Keats actually narrates that, mm-hmm. and it's well produced. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's excellent.
Twilight Zone was very successful on television, so I can't see that it wouldn't be on the radio, too.
No, it's great. Yeah. It's well done.
In fact, years ago, I remember taking a tour of the NBC studio in New York, and it was amazing the sound effects that were demonstrated, how rain, for instance, could be simulated, mm-hmm. and I think a horse clippity-clop. And it was just amazing. So radio can reproduce. In fact, it may be better than television even. It can help.
Theater of the mind.
The imagination, I was going to say.
That's
right. And let's see, Thursday. Oh, the Restaurant's Corner. Yes, I've heard this too.
Well,
Alan Zeman and Richard Tyler.
I got Alan Zeman and Richard Tyler from KTKT. That's the first show. Mm-hmm. I thought those guys were so upbeat. Mm-hmm. Information and entertainment, which is what makes talk radio fun, and mm-hmm. still get what you need. And those guys mm-hmm. had it. It's just that they were dealing with restaurants and cooking and food. Mm-hmm. So what? There's a lot of interest in that.
Absolutely.
So I brought them on, I think, the first part of February. So they're there, about 10, 11 months now at the radio station, doing mm-hmm. very well.
I know some other people have come over, too. Let me see, where is...
The big one's Saturday.
Franzi is the one I was trying to find him there.
Franzi here.
Yeah, 8 o'clock to noon on Saturday.
And Sunday.
Oh, and Sunday.
And Sunday,
okay.
Yeah.
Inside Track with he and Tom Danahy, is it?
Yeah, now the interesting thing about Franzi, he had a one-hour show Monday through Friday at KTKT.
Yeah.
The first
except
thing
Thursday.
KT, yeah, except Thursday,
because
the
restaurant people had it. Yeah.
That's good. You read my menu. And what happened was they decided to eliminate the daytime talk show and then bring those guys on the weekend. Uh-huh. And then eventually it was like they didn't feel that they were getting the numbers, with the station because they were changing things around. Mm-hmm. So when I talked to Franzi, I said, man, you got a good show. I'd like to promote you and bring you here. You can be, it's a family at the Jolt. Yeah, we all want to succeed together, so we help each other. We help with the promotions with him, help him do the commercials. And he's got a great little show going.
Yeah, he does.
He's got Tom Danahy from the Tucson Weekly. Mm-hmm. He's fairly, I guess I can say the word liberal, in case he sees this show. and Franzi's very conservative, so those guys get to beat it up a little bit. And then the same thing on Sunday with Mike Tully. So you get the yin and the yang, so to speak.
You make me think of a family that that actually does exist. What's your name? Mary Matlin and James Carville.
Oh, they're great.
How they
to
ever
watch.
Stay married?
I don't think they are. I think that's all make believe because there's no way that I could have ever done that.
I couldn't do it either, having such different views. But they seem to have a strong marriage somehow. I don't know. So Saturday you start with Alan Colmes from 1 to 4 a.m. My mm-hmm. God, that must be taped.
Yeah, because the problem with Alan, which straight from the beginning, is he doesn't even do his show live until after Hannity and Combs.
I see.
And so he's not even on the air till 10, 11 o'clock our time to start with live. So,
oh,
I mean, I'd love to get him up in the playlist a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would do it in a heartbeat.
What is Sightings about from 4 a.m. to 5:30 a.m.?
Well, that's a very strange show. there's a group of individuals out there that are UFO buffs.
Oh, okay.
And incidentally, I just picked up a show that starts Monday. I'll just plug this a little
sure,
bit, called Dr. Sky.
Okay.
And he's out of Phoenix, and he does specials on astronomy,
okay.
You know, dealing with science and astronomy.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of people that are still into UFO sightings, the whole phenomena, crop circles, whatever,
mm-hmm.
and that's pretty much what that's about.
Okay, interesting. Well, I know another station in town had some success with that, so I think
with
you're
Art
probably
Bell.
Right track. Yeah.
Yeah, Art Bell's he's the king of that.
Yeah.
You know, conspiracy and Area 51 and Colonel James Jameson.
But I think he's retired now. Isn't
No, he's still working on the weekends.
Oh,
I think George Norrie is doing his thing at night called Coast to Coast. It's still a very good show.
Okay.
It's still well done.
Well, it's very nice that you're saying something nice about the competition.
They've got to keep an eye on them.
You bet. Let's see, weekly public affair from, it must be affairs, from 5:30 to 6 a.m.
Yeah, there's a couple of things about radio stations with FCC requirements. They have to have a 30-minute show.
Okay.
I try to take it beyond that, though, with mm-hmm. fundraisings and working with individual arthritis, MS, you know, all those groups one-on-one. I mean, we take mm-hmm. it a whole different step beyond that even.
Good. Okay. And then 6 to 7 a.m., Drivers Talk Radio. What do drivers talk about on the radio?
I just picked that up about almost 3 months ago. There's a big following of NASCAR fans in this country.
Oh, okay.
It's huge.
That's true.
So they have this show live out of Las Vegas, and they
mm-hmm.
deal with all the races that are going on that week and the point system and just a myriad of the NASCAR series.
Mm-hmm.
So I figured I'd throw it on, you know, in a place where I could start and see how it does, and see if there's people that, you know, either email me or phone call and say, hey, you know, mm-hmm. could you put that on at in drive time?
Okay.
This probably won't happen, but you could ask.
Let's see, 7 to 8 is handyman Glenn
Haig.
Mm-hmm. And you have an 800 number for him.
Yeah, ask the handyman. People call in and say, mm-hmm. you know, I've got this leak in my kitchen. It was there for like 18 months. How do I get rid of the stain? Or, you know, what can I clean my floor with? Or what should I build this with? And, you know, it's
mm-hmm.
It's a lot of information there with him.
You know, before we go on, I'd like to ask, is this available to anyone who calls the station? Would you mail them a
Actually,
program?
You can I'll mail them a program. They can go to the website. It's on the website. Every show also has an individual biography of each one of the talk show hosts that are on the station.
Yeah. Excellent.
Including the staff. There's great pictures of each one of us there.
Why don't we bring that up on the screen then and let people see it. If you'd like to get a copy of this program, contact the Jolt at, there it is, 4320 North Campbell Avenue, Tucson, Arizona. What's the zip?
85718.
Or call them and they'll just request it by calling 529-5865 or go to the website www.tucsonsjolt.com and just request it. But in the meantime, we'll go on for those people who are interested just in hearing at this point. Let's see. So then the next one is the inside track. We talked about that mm-hmm. with Emil Franzi and Tom Denny from 8 to noon. That's 4 hours. Boy, do they have a lot to talk about for
four
hours?
Well, they do. I mean, they bring different people, and they'll bring in all the county supervisors, Ray Carroll. Mm-hmm. They bring in Fred Ronstadt. They're bringing the mayor.
Well, that sounds interesting.
Yeah, so they're bringing in a lot of that. And then they're also bringing in individuals dealing with other subject matter, not just politics, animals.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Then from noon to 2, we have the general...
Cigar Dave.
What is he?
The general?
Is he a general?
Front and centers, you know. Yeah, he's the general.
Is there worth 2 hours worth of talk on cigars?
I got to tell you, yeah.
Really?
Okay. We've had him for about 4 years on the station. He works out of Tampa at
mm-hmm.
I think it's WFTL in Tampa, St.
Mm-hmm.
Petersburg, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
The cigar capital of the United
States. Is that right? Well, I guess not too far from Cuba.
It's still pretty far because you can't get Cuban cigars, yet legally yet. But
I mean, in the past, it became that because of the proximity.
Yeah, I think they make Garcia Vega and something else. Tampa's a very big town cigar making wise. But you know, the other thing with it, he deals with libations. The food that goes with it. It's a whole continent of different things with it.
And then from 2 to 4, the movie show on radio. So people discuss movies.
Mad Max and Bill Mayo. That's live also. Yeah, they do. They discuss movies.
Is that our Max from another radio station?
No.
Or is that?
No, that's, I know who you're talking about. Yeah. No, this Mad Max has been around longer than the other Mad Max.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. And then from 4 to 6 p.m., Talking Pets with John Patch.
Yeah, and I just picked that up 2 weeks ago in San Diego when I went to the broadcasters convention there. That's a live show. He deals with anything from ants to elephants to, you know, baboons to zebras, fish, cats, dogs, birds, you know, everything. Mm-hmm. So an interesting guy, too.
So people who have pets, we could tune in and learn.
Well, yeah, because when I talk to him, he seems to have this ability to be psychic with the animals along with just talking about some of the scientific part of it from a medical point of view. So there's some... He talks about behavior and how to deal with that. You know, I don't know how you can behave with a fish, but we'll just go find out.
Well, I guess the basic psychology of approach and avoidance. Other than that, I don't know.
It looks like a hook and a piece of meat to me.
Shame on you. Just kidding. Okay, and this next program I really do like a lot. From 6 to 9, Handle on the Law. You know,
Bill
He's Handel, great.
He is the best.
He's the
best. Marginal legal advice, as Bill says. And, you know, he's just animated. Yeah. And he's the only person that I've ever seen on radio that will tell you something legally and tell you how stupid you were about not doing something legally, you know, appropriately. And,
yeah, but he's also helpful.
Oh, he's very helpful. You know, when you tell you're an idiot, you know, why did you do that? Now you really need an attorney.
And then from 9 to 1, 9 p.m. to 1 a.m., all comedy radio. Those are what, Fergie and Molly and
no,
old-timer
actually,
kind of things?
No, actually, we just picked that up 2 weeks ago also from San Diego. We're the first station in Tucson that has all comedy radio, which is a very, very big, it's Frasier is part of the package. It's brand new. It's only been out for about 3 months. I've watched it for a couple of months. Uh-huh. It's hilarious.
So it's current comedy.
Oh, it's very current.
It's not from the
30s
and 40s.
But it's all the famous people, too, all local sitcoms. Oh, yeah,
really?
It's big. Okay. I'm banking on this thing to be one of the neater things on Saturday night to do.
That's good to know.
Yeah, it's better than the movies.
I don't know about that, but it sounds like a lot of fun.
No, it will be.
I think I'd like to tune in and hear it. All right. So we're now on Sunday at 1 a.m. to 4 a.m. Now, when radio was, I guess that's the Fibber McGee and Molly and old-time radio.
Yep. Yeah. Stan Freberg, who's been doing that show for years and years and years.
Yeah, he's good.
And he's got he has just an incredible collection of all the old, you know, the radio stuff that was on going back to even the 20s, 20s, 30s, and 40s. A lot of stuff.
And then from 4 to 4:30, Music and the Spoken Word. What is that about?
It's the Mormon Tabernacle Choir.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well,
one of the reasons I just kind of like listening to it. It's pretty.
Well, of course. It's gorgeous. Right. I agree with you.
Yeah.
I'm not Mormon, but I love their choir. You don't have to be Mormon to appreciate it.
No, not at all.
I don't know. Then, let's see, 4:30 to 5, that's the Weekly Public Affairs. I guess that's the
I just repeat the one from
that.
Saturday so people can be up on certain things.
And then 5 to 6 a.m., CBS Roundup. That you tune into the network and get
it's a feed that tells us everything that happened the whole week, all the CBS news, all the top stories.
Okay.
So that way you can just kind of go, wow, it was a busy week.
Okay. Well, I like having a roundup in an hour. That sounds like a winner if I'm up at 5 a.m., but that would be a good thing to listen to, I would think. Tom Martino, 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. He's out of Colorado.
Yeah, he's out of Denver. He's a troubleshooter. The show we've had on 3 hours at a time. I've even had him on in the weekday.
Yeah, I've heard
of
him.
But he's doing less and less. It's a good show, and it's hard to put... The program's hard to put everything everywhere.
Yeah,
you know, so I wanted to make sure he was still on the radio station.
Okay.
So he's on Sunday morning.
And let's see, 7 to 8, Newsweek on the Air.
Yep, that's a whole different thing from a different, you know, one of the things that we try to have in a market, privately owned radio station, is a variety of different types of news services.
Okay.
I have CBS News at the top of the hour, I have CNN News at the bottom of the hour, I have Metro News, and I have Associated Press.
Oh, wow.
So the Newsweek on Air also brings in a different, you know, form of a news service that has a different slant on it. Trying to make sure that everybody's getting the same information from all the different angles.
Now, is this the Newsweek magazine we're talking about?
Yeah, basically.
Okay. Good. All right. And then we got Emil Franzi coming back from 8 a.m.
Four more hours of him beating you up.
But he's on with a different guest.
Yeah, he's on Mike Tully.
With Mike Tully. Mm-hmm. Who's Mike Tully?
Mike Tully's a lawyer, and I don't know if that's still a bad word, but it can be. But he's a liberal lawyer, So that's two bad words in the same statement. But I tell you, he's a brilliant guy. He's great with Franzi, because again, it's the yin and the yang.
Yeah.
And they both have different points of view, and they bring it out very nicely.
Interesting. It's funny, somebody had talked about getting a friend of his on this show. And turns out that this friend was a lawyer from the ACLU.
Oh boy.
And I thought, well, now this is called the American Spirit, and I that of course is an aspect, like a lot of things are an aspect of it, but do I want to highlight that alone? And I thought, well, you know what, I will if I get a yin yang, or point counterpoint is the way I thought of it at the time. And so I thought, who's a counterpoint to it? And I couldn't really come up with a perfect person, but I did think of John C. Scott, and I invited him, and he accepted. But then they said, no thanks. So I don't know exactly. I guess they didn't want
to. They want to fight or something, huh?
Well, I don't know. I admit I wouldn't want him as my enemy, but he's not my enemy. He's my friend. He's been with me on some things, and I appreciate him. But anyway, I was disappointed. I would have liked a give and take between the two of them.
Oh sure.
And he was willing to do it, but they weren't.
That's too bad.
Whatever reason. Oh well. Let's see. On from noon to two, we got American 70s Conway and Company. What's that about?
I brought that on about a little over 3 months ago. Conway and Company deals with all the music of the 70s.
Oh, okay.
And so, you know, they deal with one-hit wonders, okay, the clothing, the lifestyle, the place where we all came from at one point in time, the 70s.
Okay.
It's a great show.
Mm-hmm. And then Health Talk. Well, that's certainly...
That's Dr. Bob Martin.
Yeah, I've become more conscious of health since I had that hip replacement surgery because of arthritis. I've become very health conscious as a result. That sounds like a good topic.
Dr. Bob Martin's been on for over 4 years now, maybe 4.5 years at the station. He deals with a lot of preventative medicine. He's
good.
A big believer in terms of not just using drugs and all these other things, not that he doesn't want you to have your doctor's advice and things of that nature, but he has alternative places for people to go and pick up these different things relative to the symptoms that people call into.
So he's into alternative medicine?
Oh, very much so, yeah.
Excellent.
And he's a chiropractor, too.
Oh, okay. All right, so then from 5 to 7, we've got When Radio Was. That's, again, back to the past, and
right,
Fibbergy and Volley type.
Yep.
Okay.
Same thing.
5 to 7 p.m., and then 7 to midnight, this sounds kind of similar, old-time radio classics with Bill Randall.
The difference with that is Bill Randall started right from the beginning with the radio station.
Oh.
Bill Randall's our engineer.
Oh, is that right?
And yeah, he's just an incredible individual because he comes with about 44 years of radio experience.
Wow.
He's one of the few people that you'll run across that could actually do anything with the transmitter, which is a nightmare on any given day, all the way to the newest software and computer equipment that we use from A to Z. And what he's put together is a collection of radio things that he's been collecting since even the 30s and the 40s.
Oh.
So it's his own personal collection, and then he actually does the show. He does the talking on it.
5 hours? Boy,
yeah, but
he must go to
some
depth.
I get a ton of emails from people wanting the shows.
Is
and,
that right?
Yeah, wanting to meet him and,
good
and
for
whatnot.
Him.
Yeah, he's great.
Excellent. Now, you also have down here CBS News, top of the hour, 7 days a week. CNN News, bottom of the hour, 24/7. CBS Market Watch, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m.
That's during the weekday, Monday through Friday. We'll give you the market watch all throughout the day. So usually the repeats after 2 or 3 p.m. depending on when, what time of the year that we don't change our time, but everybody else does, so that you can keep up with how much money you lost that day.
Okay.
Or hopefully, won.
Jolt Sports, Weather, Entertainment. 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Friday, and CBS Market Watch, 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. I guess you have spots.
The traffic in the morning, when Doc Phillips is on, he's reading the news, and he's reading traffic, and then Michael Kalman, he'll do a sports short, which comes on 3 times in the 3 hours in the morning. And then Bill Harris does weather for that day for a one-minute weather segment for 3 hours in the morning. And then late in the afternoon also, too.
Well, it's quite a lineup. It's to your credit. As I say, you're the number one ranked independent in terms of listenership. I think that's to your credit. That's one of the reasons I thought it'd be great to have you on the show.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Well, you know, it sounds, my question is, how do you develop that? And you've pretty well answered it by saying you go to these conventions and you've you keeping your finger on the pulse of what's going on in talk
radio.
Yeah,
you have to be ahead of these guys just, not just a little bit, quite a bit. Mm-hmm. I don't see many of the managers of any of the markets, whether it's Clear Channel or Citadel or Journal, at any of these conventions.
Really?
So that was the first tip-off. Yeah, they'll send the regional manager, and he'll go over and just meet the big wigs and that sort of thing. So that gave me a heads-up about 5 years ago when I started going to the conventions, going, well, I should just try to meet some of these newer people.
Oh, yeah.
They're there. They have booths. They're putting out demos. I also pick up things, like Killer Tracks, is our sound library.
Oh, okay.
There's all these small bumper music, things to give the radio station a jolty feel, mm-hmm. to where it's got some vibe to it, some energy all day and night. Mm. You know, and that's part of what we try to do, ahead of those guys.
Very good. Well, to talk, this is not a call-in show, but if you want to talk to our guest, you can call him at the station, and let's see, the number is?
529-5865.
All right, 529-5865, or you probably shouldn't drop in on him because he's a very busy man, but you could call maybe for an appointment and see him. They're at 4320 North Campbell Avenue, which is is it the St. Phillips Plaza?
Yep, St. Phillips Plaza, second floor, right just east of the fountain. See that fountain? We're right there at River and Campbell.
River and Campbell, yeah. It's a beautiful area.
Now, incidentally, everybody can stop by.
Really?
Yeah, I answer all the emails. I'll take all the phone calls. When we give out prizes, I want people to come to the station and see it. When some of the staff is there, in terms of Doc Phillips or whoever, if mm-hmm. he's available, everybody's very, we want to meet our listeners.
They're
always welcome to stop by.
Well,
and
that's
if I'm
wonderful.
Not there, just say you said hi, leave your name, leave a phone number, and you can beef at me if you want, which some people do. You know how that is. You're either an idiot, or the second coming of Christ, one or the other, when it comes to entertainment.
Well, so I guess the black and white is no gray.
No, not at all.
Black and white. Boy, oh boy.
No.
Well, to contact, I've told you how to contact Pat, I almost said Pat Porter. He was your predecessor, I know.
Yes, a long
Pat
time
Johnson,
ago.
Yes, yes. Actually, I worked with him years ago. I interned at KNST, one of the rivals. This was years ago mm-hmm. in the news department. He was the station manager, or was he a program manager?
I
can't
remember.
Probably maybe a program manager at the time. Yeah, I worked with a lady by the name of Victoria Steele at the time. She was director of news. So that tells you how long, maybe it was, 7 or 8 years ago, something like that. So I'm sorry I almost slipped out with that, but I do know the difference.
I've been called worse.
You certainly have. Actually, he was a great guy.
Yeah, he was.
And very
talented. He still is. I still talk to him now and then.
Oh, good.
He's up in Phoenix.
Yeah, that's what I've heard. But to contact us here with this show, not just this individual show, but the series, you can call us at 722, you'll see it on the screen, 2837. If you have, you can give us your comments, suggestions, programming ideas, or email us at Stuart R. Thomas, that's my name, at hotmail.com. It's written all in small letters, no punctuation other than the .com and the @. So that's it. So, well, Pat, you have been in radio for quite a while, I guess, right? I
mean, you've on and off. I've been with this station almost about 5.5 years now.
Wow, wow. Yeah. As a little child, I do this now. I go biographical. I like to know people's stories.
Okay.
There was a church that I belonged to, where the minister said the interesting thing about people are their stories. So I'm going to get into your story.
Okay.
When you were a little child, did you imagine yourself doing this kind of work?
Not in radio per se. Mm-hmm. I used to go to bed with a small we only had AM radio back
then. Okay, I understand.
You're
my generation.
There weren't even cassettes or CDs or any of that stuff. It was just, AM radio. I used to go to bed with a radio under my
no kidding.
In the pillow and just kind of listen to it. And then I'm a classically trained violinist also, too.
Really? Yeah. Wow.
So I've always been around the music industry. And then in the late 70s, I was in a heavy metal band, rock band that did that for quite a few years. So I've always been around radio and recording, studios, things of that nature.
When you listened to that radio, was it listening to music or was it listening to talk radio?
Mostly just classical music, but I used to listen to Steve King when he first came on, Larry mm-hmm. King.
Oh yeah,
I grew up in South Florida.
He's my role model, Larry King.
Yeah.
He and Oprah.
Yeah.
I don't do the same show as Oprah, but I like to do shows with have substance and value.
Larry King was great on the radio. He was at WILD in Miami.
Do you know how he got started?
No, I really
He wrote a book on that, and it included the story how he got started. How he got started was he grew up in Brooklyn, and he moved down to the Miami Beach area because he was told that a lot of people retired from the Brooklyn area, the New York City area, and they his accent could go over well there. So he did some volunteer work at a station, and there was nothing for him at the start. But he hung around, and suddenly it was a spot open, and he got a morning drive time, of all things, which is a big
that's
thing
huge.
To have.
That's huge.
And so this was his dream. So the story is he was offered this time slot, and he was thrilled. He went home, he practiced, he was all ready. He goes into the station, and he's ready to start the show. The engineer cues him up, and he blanks. Nothing comes out of his mouth. And the station manager soon bangs on the door, throws open the door, and says, "Don't you know there's a communication business?" and slams the door. And what happened was, instead of just being so embarrassed and you know, so he just quit, he actually explained to his listeners what happened, how this was such a great opportunity for him, and he blanked out, that he was prepared, but he blanked out, and the station manager just did what he did. And they empathize with him.
So he got the sympathy vote right off the bat. Huh?
Well, or empathy, or whatever you want to call it. And that got him started. It's interesting how people get started.
Yeah. Well, Larry King's good. He's been around a long time.
Yes, he has.
But
yeah,
Steve really Kane, and I always have been a talk show listener, just for years and years and years.
Where'd you grow up?
I was born in Queens, New York, and I grew up in a city called Pompano Beach, Florida, which is just north of Fort Lauderdale.
Where were you born? I was born in Jamaica Hospital in Queens.
So was I.
You were born in Jamaica Hospital in Queens?
Yes, I was.
Oh, my God.
Now, you want to talk about years? Yep, I was.
I'm not kidding. I lived in Richmond Hill for the first 6 years of my life, and then we moved to Westchester, in different parts of Westchester County. I graduated from White Plains High School in White Plains, New York. But I was born in Queens.
I was 7 years old when my parents moved down to Florida.
Oh, so you moved out of Queens early,
very
too,
quickly,
in your life.
Yeah. But I was born in Jamaica.
And you grew up in Pompano Beach?
Yeah. You know, we did about 2 years in Fort Lauderdale when they first moved to Florida, and then we moved to Pompano Beach, and I grew up there, lived there until I was in Pompano Beach till in my 30s.
Where did you live in Queens?
I 169th Street.
Well, what community?
I don't remember.
Oh, okay.
You'd have to call my mom.
Oh. We are on 118th Street.
I know 169th Street, but I think it was New Hyde Park.
Oh, yeah, New Hyde Park. Long Island Jewish Hospital's there. It's a very good hospital.
Right. But yeah, I was born in Jamaica, though.
Jamaica Hospital?
Yep, Jamaica Hospital.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. My grandfather was a doctor there, but he died before I was born. So, and I have a feeling I'm older.
I think everybody's
from
New York, aren't they?
I don't know. I guess I've gotten a little personal here, but when you said Jamaica Hospital, that certainly rang a bell with
that's
me.
That's spooky, actually.
It is, in a way. Yeah. Well, I have a feeling you were born a lot closer to this date than I was. I was born in 1941.
I was born in 52.
52, mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you're younger, but sort of the same generation, anyway.
I'm a baby boomer.
Yeah, you are.
As they say, I'm a true baby boomer.
Interesting.
I still feel like a baby boomer.
Interesting. So you spent some time in much of your growing up life, as a child, a youth, in Pompano Beach.
Yeah, in South Florida.
And when did you leave there?
I left there in 1986. Mm-hmm. I went to Phoenix for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't recommend anybody live in Phoenix. It's way too hot and way too many people, even then. And then I came to Tucson, which is a great town.
And you've been here about 5 years, you said?
Oh, no, I've been in Tucson since 89.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, long time.
And when did you start in radio?
Here about 5.5 years ago, as far as being
general.
In a station. Oh. Never, I've always was with bands and recording studios.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I've just been an avid, big-time radio listener, so I kind of knew the business, knew the industry. Mm-hmm. See, I've always been flying below the radar with all these guys in town here. Hopefully they're not watching the show. Go, wait a minute, this guy has not been in the business 20 years? No.
No, it doesn't, sometimes people can have, if you have 20 years of experience, it could be 1 year just many times over instead of really 20 years. So, you're effective. That's the main thing.
Yep, I know.
I mean, this programming shows it. The fact that you're the number one independent in terms of listenership shows it. So whatever your background, the payoff is the results and you getting the results.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, thank you. I mean, you're doing a great job from what I can tell. But I'm just wondering how that developed, because obviously somehow it developed somehow.
Well, it's also the people in the environment, too. There's only six employees. for the most part. You know, I think you've stopped by the radio station before.
Yeah, I have.
And everybody does everything, okay. You know, which makes it,
sense,
and
yeah.
it's a team thing. We talk about what new programming, you know, we may be going after. Mm-hmm. I let people listen to the demos that we have that we get from all over the country. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it's a high five when we do a good thing. And it's, mm-hmm. you know, it's all brother and sister, brother and brother fighting when we don't agree with something. But we get over it.
Well, I so how did you get your knowledge? You must have gotten it somehow.
Well,
because you obviously have gotten it.
There's three big things. The first thing is research like you do, mm-hmm. Going to the conventions, finding yeah. out everything from the state-of-the-art equipment to the talent that's out there, mm-hmm. Meeting other people from other environments, because every city has its own culture and feel. Mm-hmm. And what works in some cities may or may not work in other cities. And just talking to people in general. I mean, when I was first getting involved with the radio station, and to this day, it's the emails and the phone calls, mm-hmm. and talking to people out in the street. So what do you think of this show? What do you think of that show? Mm-hmm. And what sort of subject matter do you like, you know, somebody to cover? Because in looking for local programming, that's the thing that I ask some people. You know, mm-hmm. where's the diversity? Or is it that you have some sort of a niche? A show like Talking Pets, for example, mm-hmm. he's got a little bit of a niche, mm-hmm. and he's only going to talk about pets. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's a real art form, not to deviate from away from whatever your best subject matter is, unless you're somebody like a Bill O'Reilly.
Yeah.
You know, he's got a staff of 40 people helping
really?
Him too. You know? But you know, he's good at what
cool
he does.
That was a coup getting him.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it really was. Yeah.
But
yeah,
and Dr. Laura.
Yep. That was very sneaky getting Dr. Laura. Well, but you know, you gotta do what you gotta do. But yeah, it's out reading. It's getting trade journals, it's paying attention to the I'm on the internet a lot. Mm-hmm. I spend a good part of the morning just on the internet with all the both TV and radio things that are out there. You know, Radio Bureau, allaccess.com, which is a pretty good you know, thing to get all the radio news, and if I hear or see
really?
Or something, oh sure.
Radio.com?
Well, allaccess.com. Oh. Yeah, that's a great site, actually.
ALL? Like
ALLACCESS.com. For example, they came out and said Mel is going to be running Sirius. You knew Howard yeah. Stern just, you know, yeah. signed a gajillion dollar a year contract.
Yeah.
You know, those guys are making tons of money. So now Mel's left Infinity and Westward One. He's going to Sirius. It's time to, you know, time to get serious and pay attention to those guys.
You do you know? See them as a major competition?
I do. Eventually, it reminds me a little bit of cable TV. You know, in the beginning, everybody said, "Well, you know, I don't want to pay $30 a month for cable TV when it's free."
Yeah.
But there was no commercials then, and all of a sudden, a commercial came in here, commercial came in there, and pretty soon you're paying $80 a month with tons of commercials, and you don't complain. The thing is getting it off, and what Sirius is trying to do is to make a big deal with a car manufacturer, because that's the key. If they get these satellite systems in the cars, then they can give 3 months free, you know, in communities, you know, wherever you buy the vehicles. And if he can pull that off, then they'll get off the ground.
Cars seem to be almost a godsend for AM radio.
Absolutely.
Because when FM came on, and then TV, particularly TV, I don't know. It seems like cars saved the day.
Well, part of it, there's a couple of things happened. Events happened over the last 5 to 7 years. You had the Gulf War. That kind of got radio up a little bit, especially AM radio, because mm-hmm. FM radio historically doesn't get into a lot of the news service stuff. Mm-hmm. You may get a news story on an FM station, but it's all about playing whatever tunes 40 times in a week, you know, because that's how they make their money. Mm-hmm. But with AM radio, especially talk radio, it came to where people have opinions now, call in. That's how Rush got mm-hmm. very big.
Yeah.
And now with 911, and it just really increased. It doubled. Everybody wanted to know what was going on with this country. And it's mm-hmm. still that way, actually. Yeah. AM radio is doing very well.
How did it get so conservative?
Well, a couple of reasons. I think, first of all, most of the guys that did talk show were trying to emulate and copy Rush. Because he's been doing this for so long. I said, man, if I had a show like Rush, you know, I could be competitive in a geographical area. I'll just put my spin on it. Okay. Thus, that's how people like Sean Hannity came out, you know, and they stayed in that AM band. Mm-hmm. The other thing is that they seem to be more on the factual side. Now, I'm not comparing liberal with conservative, but you'll notice that most of the liberal talk shows deal a lot with factual information, where the liberal or the conservatives deal with factual information, and the liberal side seems to deal more with emotion. That's still to this day. The only person that doesn't really lean a lot on emotion is Alan Combs. That was one of the things that impressed me about his show right from the get-go, is that he had facts and he was ready to fight the conservative side, you know, of what he was trying to bring across as a point. But the rest of them that have come out, like Franken, Al Franken, he's not very factual when you listen to his show. He's funny. He's very entertaining. It's actually a very good radio show.
I haven't heard it. It's not a regular radio.
It's on Air America. Yeah, and I've listened to it many times, and it has a lot of potential. But it's just like Dennis Miller, except on the other side.
I see.
You see? So, I mean, it's, but it's entertaining. I don't know if he'll make it, or Air America.
What do you think is the future of AM/FM radio, considering the competition now with this, what is it,
IBOC. Digital Satellite and IBOC is, you know, the thing that's been out. They're going to have to fix one segment of the IBOC. When you send out a digital radio signal, the FM band's not a problem. But with the AM band, the signal actually goes out analog first, and then the digital signal catches it down the line. And what happens at night, it bleeds over the AM band. So you wouldn't be able to have any AM radio at night. And, you know, we're not going to stand for that.
Well, yeah, right.
I mean, even Senator McCain would help me with that. I hope.
But there's Sirius, and isn't there XM or something like that?
Yeah, XM and Sirius are satellite radios. Yeah. We're talking about broadcasting out like a tower like we have into a whole digital system, totally separate from the satellite system.
Is there any danger of AM and FM not succeeding because of the competition of free radio, though?
I don't think so. You know, it's what it does is makes it real competitive. Yeah. And there's nothing wrong with competition because these guys need that. Yeah, now these guys need that because if right now a lot of these, you can go from city to city, which I have done, all over this country, and you'll hear the same newscasts, the same commercials, the same news service in all the cities, and because they feel that's popular and that's what's going to make them money.
Right.
What scares me about that is that there's no diversity within all of that. So there's quite a few stations now that are locked into this, just the same type of news service, the same type of commercial. Pretty soon they're going to get it to where it's just their point of view and nobody else's. And that's the part that bothers me, and that's the fight to have the station be as diverse as possible.
Well, it sounds like you're doing a great job. I certainly am not in a position to judge other than as an outsider, but as an outsider, it sounds like you're doing a great job to me.
Well, we need to double the ratings, and then if I can catch that Clear Channel station,
well,
I'd be very happy.
Let me ask you, what do you see as the future of the Jolt? What would you like to
see? We'll double the ratings. Yeah, another thing having a small radio station is we don't have the big advertising dollars.
Yeah, I understand.
And my other fight is when I did billboards, I had to actually go to Clear Channel to have billboards approved, which that kind of hurts a little bit. I'm actually taking money, giving them money just so I can put out a product so that I can compete against them. And I had the same problem with I was bringing Imus to town.
Oh, yes.
And I would have to get that approved if I was going to use one of the casino venues through Clear Channel, and I wasn't going to do that.
So how did you do it?
I didn't.
Oh, you did it?
No,
anyway.
I'm not bringing Imus right now. I'm bringing Phil Henry to town.
I thought you meant the show. You meant the person.
No, bring him live. Do a live remote.
Oh, wow.
And now I have to have a venue for that. I can't have Don Imus at the radio station.
I understand.
You know, he'll bash me for the rest of my life if I did that. You know, he's got to have a limousine and be at a nice venue like a casino, which is a nice place, you know, to have it. And I would have had to have that approved by Clear Channel.
Is that right?
That's right. So that makes it a tougher fight.
I don't understand that. Why?
Because they're the ones
that the billboards?
They own the rights to the concert venues.
They do?
Yeah, pretty much.
Wow.
Yeah.
Pretty powerful, aren't they?
Yeah, that's why I'm telling people, pay attention. Same thing with the billboards.
Yeah, are they willing to put your ads on their billboards?
Yeah, they would probably not do real well if I said, look, I'd like to spend, you know, $40,000+ on billboards, and they go, well, no, because you're the competition.
Well, yeah.
That wouldn't look very good. No, they'll do it. They did it before. It was just hard to, I went through an ad agency just so I could give the check to the ad agency and not to the
church.
That's how I got through it. Yeah, it was terrible.
Well, it seems to me I've seen billboards a while ago with Imus.
Yeah, I did. I did Imus on there. It's Sean Hannity on there with Phil Hendry.
Yeah, and I think I've also seen one when his brother, or is it his brother?
Yeah, Fred.
Fred Imus and, mm-hmm. and Nicole Cox were doing the show. I think I saw one there too. So I guess you've succeeded somehow in getting them to take your money, and as long as they're willing to put up a billboard.
As long as you tell them it's $40,000, everybody takes money, you know.
So you'd like to see the ratings doubled, and how are you planning to do that?
The programming is pretty tight right now.
It's really good.
And the idea is to start to invest money. I need to increase the sales staff so we can get the word out. Yeah. We're going to be working on a campaign for billboards again, mm-hmm. and we're very deep in the community in terms of clubs and fundraisers, mm-hmm. Whatever we have to do to get the word out, because the interesting thing about the radio station, which is another good story, is about 2.5-3 years ago, according to Arbitron, which mm-hmm. we're not a subscriber, but I will tell you this because they said this was fair game, is people only used to listen 4.2 hours a week to the Jolt, and now one listener will listen 7.6 hours a week. So I've almost doubled the time that they want to listen to the radio station,
awesome.
And we went from 9,200 cum to 38,400. And
cum
meaning the average quarter hour that somebody's listening to the radio station.
I see. And so, what was that? I was trying to understand.
Well, you see where it says here when it says 38,400?
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's the listeners, right?
Yep, the average listeners.
The average listeners,
now.
Right.
So I'm trying to get that to about 90,000 over the next year.
Well, that'd be great.
Yeah.
That well,
we went up 38% last year, and this year it looks like we're going to be around 36 to 37%. So that'll put me to where if I could get about 40 to 42%, growth in listenership, then we'll be knocking on the big boys' door.
Oh, I think your lineup is certainly competitive with the big boy store right now,
mm-hmm.
from what I can see. I mean, Alan Combs, Laura Schlesinger, Bill O'Reilly. You got a very strong lineup, and that's to your credit. I think your boss must be very happy with you because you are certainly competing. So you'd like to double your listenership.
I think it's a matter now to double the listenership. Is to have people know that we exist. Mm-hmm. It's hard on an AM band because, first of all, a lot of home stereos don't have good AM bands anyways.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. So they don't put a lot of money into the AM systems. It's CD players and FM systems.
I've noticed almost all the top stations here in terms of listenership are FM.
Yeah.
Actually, if I just counted the AM, you'd be way up even more.
Yeah.
Because, mm-hmm. let's see, the top six are all FM. Well, although there's one AM tied for
that's
six.
That's one I'm going after, by the way.
Okay. But then the others, I go down the line here, my God, I don't get another AM till number 12,
mm-hmm.
and that's an AM FM.
Yep.
That's KUAZ.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's one more at 15. So what I count, about four? Mm-hmm. And then you're number five. Considering you're a fairly young station, let's see, you were licensed in 1999, you established locally in 1998. I mean, you've done astoundingly well, it seems to me.
The goal is to move across and past a couple of stations just in general to start,
mm-hmm.
the other talk stations that existed. Mm-hmm. KTKT, we can talk about them now because they're not the same phone around anymore.
Yeah,
but 4 years ago, that was competition.
I know.
And we're trying to go after them.
They had a good lineup too, actually.
They did.
They decided to change it. That's their choice.
I hope
they get a lot of Spanish listeners to the other one, the change, because I'm kind of disappointed they changed it. But then there's the Jolt now to listen to.
Yeah, and the idea is to get the best nationally syndicated programs and the best local programs.
Mm-hmm.
That's still the goal of the radio station. And I'm sure there's other shows out there here locally that we'll be able to facilitate here in the near future.
Now, you mentioned increasing the sales force. I think mm-hmm. I've heard commercials on your station, or not necessarily commercials, but announcements, mentioning it. You're looking for a sales force.
Jolt's growing by leaps and bounds.
So
come on and join the family.
If people want to join the family,
they can give me a call.
Give Pat Johnston. Let's quickly give that that number once again. To reach Pat Johnson, it's, let me see, 529-5865, 529-5865. And, or you, or, well, you have it there. You've got the website, you have the address. They are willing to accept walk-ins. And so, yeah. Do you train people to...
I mean, sales is a sales is a tough animal in any business, especially radio. You're selling dead air, I mean, literally. But yeah, we train. I mean, you have to know the shows, going after the demographics. What is the advertiser looking for? Mm-hmm. What is he trying to accomplish with? And we do everything in house. We produce the commercials in house. Although ad agencies will give us spots. You know, we run all the major ad agencies in terms of some of their clients, but. Any local advertising, bend over backwards. We'll help them write the script. We'll produce the commercial and everything for them right there.
Do you have the capacity to do that?
Oh, yes, you do. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we have all the best recording equipment. You know, Wave Station, Cool Edit, Pro Audio Tools. I mean, we have everything the big guys have in terms of recording. Mm-hmm. It just is not as big a building, and the general manager's office isn't as big as that general manager's office. But I'm working on that.
But listen, it's what comes over the airways that's the most important.
Yes, it is.
Pat, we've been talking for a while. We're almost out of time. Is there anything that you might like to mention that we didn't cover?
No, I think you hit all the bases. You know, get people to listen to the station. That would be nice. The more the merrier. You know, like I said, stop by, give a call. I'd be happy to have everybody meet the on-air people and give you a little tour of the radio station.
Do you have pictures of the on-air people that be?
Yeah, they're all on the website. Yeah, you can go to the website and you can see everybody that works there at the radio station. Now, don't believe some of the bios that are on there. Okay?
Oh, is that right?
Especially mine.
Well, you've given us your bio here. I don't know it. We haven't been, resume perfect, but we have a general idea. The big thing is you have success. Well, unfortunately, we have to wrap up. So let me just once again thank you, Pat Johnson, the general manager of KJLL 1330, The Jolt, for being a guest on the show.
Thank you.
I'm your host, Stuart Thomas. In 2 weeks, we're going to have Paul LeCure, who does seminars, and we're going to talk about relationship building, and he does seminars on that topic. Join us then. This is your host, Stuart Thomas, saying good night, and thanks for being with us.